Good morning, children. Welcome back to today's reading time. Today, I am going to tell you the story of Luna, the girl who drank the moon. The girl who drank the moon tells the story of Luna, the latest in a line of babies that the people of the protectorate sacrificed to the witch of the forest in a bid to keep their town safe. Only as readers quickly discover that the witch is a gentlewoman who rescues babies and helps them get adopted. On the day of sacrifice, the elders of the protectorate led a procession of villagers into the dangerous woods, where they abandoned as a sacrifice to the witch the people believes lives in the woods, the youngest baby in the village. The village elders use stories about the witch, which they believe to be untrue, to make the people afraid and keep them from wanting to leave the protectorate. They also prevent people from leaving because they own the road. The road is the only way through the treacherous forest and into the free cities, and the elders charge a high fee for using it. On the other edge of the protectorate is the bog, which is the natural resource many people use to sustain their work in the protectorate. None of the people in the protectorate have ever been to the free cities, not even the elders. Andine is the nephew of Grand Elder Gerland and himself an elder in training. At 13, he is a hardworking, kind and thoughtful young man. When he attended his first day of sacrifice as an elder in training, he is anxious as he follows his uncle Gerland to the home of the young couple. When they get there, the mother is hanging from the rafters and holding her baby while screaming and crying. Gerland notes the crescent moon birthmark that both mother and baby have on their forehead. Andine is full not only of sorrow and guilt as he watches the mother of the youngest baby in the village who refused to give up her daughter for the sacrifice be dragged away to the tower by the sisters of the star, but also of questions as the elders then leave the baby alone in the woods. He is worried that the baby will be eaten by animals in the woods before the witch arrives to take her. The elders all assume that the animals of the forest will eat the baby, since they believe the witch is a story they made up. However, there is a witch in the woods who comes to take the babies left in the woods every year. Her name is Zan, and she calls the protectorate the city of sorrows because of the sorrow that obfuscates everything about the place. She cannot use her magic to see into its walls and understand why people leave their babies out in the woods every year. But she always comes to take the baby and escort it safely through the woods to the free cities, where she places it with a loving family. Zan and the people of the free cities call these children star children. Always found by Zan in the woods outside the cities of the sorrows on Star Child Day, because by the time they arrive with Zan to the free cities, their skin and eyes glow with the starlight she feeds them by hand during their journey. For reasons Zan is either unable to remember or unable to understand, she delays her journey through the woods with this child, opting to slow down to show her certain waterfalls or tells her stories or sings her songs. As a result of the delays in the journey, the phases of the moon waxed until eventually Zan was not only feeding the baby fingertips of starlight, but the pure moonlight of a full moon. Because this baby ate moonlight, she was not only blessed like the other star children, but enmagicked, realizing what she had done and that no ordinary family in the free cities would be able to raise a baby with so much magic infused in her bones. She decided to name the baby Luna and adopt her as a granddaughter. Over the next several years, Zan raised Luna in her treehouse in the forest at the edge of the bog with her friends. Glurk, the bog monster, and Freyan, a very tiny dragon, Luna is adored by her family in the woods, and she loves accompanying Zan on her trips to the free cities to visit with people and help them with whatever magic she can. But at the age of 5, her magic starts to seep out of her and she is changing the world around her without even noticing. As Zan ages, she is unable to keep up with Luna and her fanciful acts of magic. One day, Luna accidentally turns Glurk into a bunny rabbit. After turning him back, Zan casts a spell to beat away Luna's magic until she turns 13, buying them time to teach her how to harness her power and control herself before her very powerful magic is let loose again. An understood consequence of the spell is that when Luna regains access to her magic, Zan's magic will leave her body. Since Zan is a human over 500 years old, she will die when Luna turns 13. However, Zan believes that this is worth the sacrifice as she remembers her mentor, Zosimos. Similarly, losing his magic and aging more and more rapidly as he trained her when she was young. She decides that this will be a quicker version of the same and that the benefit of Luna will be worthwhile. An unknown consequence of the spell is that Luna cannot understand or remember anything she has already learned about magic or anything anyone tells her about it, not even the world itself. Glurk and Zan worrying that they made the wrong decision. They are not sure how to prepare Luna for what will happen when she turns 13, but they do their best to raise her as normally as possible. During this time, Antane has been refusing to attend the day of sacrifice processions in the protectorate, finding a new excuse each year. After the 5th year, he evades one. He goes to the tower where the sisters of the stars live to see the prisoner. They keep there the woman who was once the mother of the baby he believes he helped sacrifice to the witch. Antane encounters the head sister Ignatia, who he knew when he was an apprentice to the tower. Before he became an elder in training, she correctly guesses that he would prefer to be a carpenter than a council member and shows him the way to the cell where the mad woman is. In the mad woman's cell, there are thousands of folded paper birds. The sisters of the star tell Antane that each day they sweep the paper out of the room. But each day, somehow, she is able to conjure paper and create these folded birds. The woman in the cell awakens and tells Antane that the witch is real and that she is here. Despite remembering Antane from the day her daughter was taken for the day of sacrifice, the woman is nice to him. However, Antane is attacked by a flurry of the paper birds, scarring his face permanently, and when he beats the door to be let out of the cell by the sisters, nobody on the other side hears his calls. During the attack, the madwoman falls asleep, drained from whatever torture she endures in the tower. The head sister has no explanation for these seemingly magical events. Over the next several years, Antane resigns from this position as elder in training and became an excellent carpenter, renowned all over the protectorate and free cities. His overbearing mother, who once pressured him to participate in the council, claims that it was always her idea for him to be a carpenter. The very odd scare pattern on his face makes people avoid him. So, he leads a solitary but industrious life in the protectorate. Meanwhile, the mad woman realizes that although she was suffered so much sorrow while in the tower that she has forgotten her own name, she starts to have dreams of her daughter growing up safe and happy somewhere in the woods. These dreams and her growing magical power to make paper and quill and ink out of nothing encourage her, and she locks away her sorrow behind a big wall of hope. As her hope increases, she realizes that the witch is not in the woods. The real witch is the head sister Ignatia, who eats the sorrow of those around her. By veiling up sorrow behind hope, the madwoman is able to weaken Ignatia bit by bit, starving her of the sorrow she was eating from the madwoman's soul. As Luna grows up, Glark, Zan, and Freyan do their best to raise her. She is a smart, kind, and beloved young girl. Shortly before Luna turns 13, she realizes that over the years, the lies told between her and her family members have grown and grown. When Zan finally dies, Glark is revealed to be more than a monster. He is the Bog, the poet, a creator who sang the world into being. He and Zan leave to wander the world, and Glark leaves behind a poem for Luna. The novel, which has alternated between the current events and stories told by mothers to their children, ends with the mother, likely Ethrin, telling Lucan about the good magic of witches and bogs. She says that stories are the same as witches or beasts or bogs or poems or the world. The Girl Who Drank the Moon successfully presents a fairy tale that serves not only to entertain but to also educate children on corruption, selfishness, and oppression, as well as the importance of banding together and striving to do what is right in trying circumstances. Thank you, children.